Now, before we go ahead and we code the solution, let's do a 5-minute analysis here of how to approach this solution. So as we said clearly in our problem definition that we would like to add new logging functionality without disturbing the customer class. So that's our end goal. Alright. So what's the problem here? Currently, the logging functionality is completely entangled into the customer class. In other words, the customer class is violating SRP principle. That is single responsibility principle. SRP says that, you know, the class or a module or a code, you know, should have only one and one reason to change. For example, probably our customer class should only change, you know, when there are some kind of validation changes in the customer last name or probably in the customer first name. So other than that, you know, probably the customer class should not change. But currently, because your logging functionality is a part of this customer class, so whenever you change this logging functionality, you have to also go and compile the customer class. So in other words, your customer class is doing work, you know, which he is not supposed to do. So the solution is pretty simple here. As we said that the customer class is not following the SRP principle, that is the single responsibility principle. In other words, it is doing too many things. So if somehow we move the error handling routine into some other class or some other project, right? And then whenever we add any kind of class into that project, you don't have to change the customer project. So in other words, we have to move the error handling routine, you know, completely away from the customer class. So here's how the solution would look like. Currently our solution is a three-tier architecture. We have the user interface, we have the middle tier, and then we have the data access layer. So probably our solution would be that, you know, we are going to create one more project here called as an exception project. Okay. And this exception project will be referred in the middle tier. So whenever we want to add a new exception logic or exception class, what we can do is basically we can just go and add this class over here, and we don't need to go and change in the middle tier. So let's go ahead and let's code this solution. So the first step is, let's go ahead and add one more project here called as exceptions. So let's go ahead and add a new project called as exception. So this will be basically a class library. So whenever, you know, we want to add new exception logics, we are going to add over here. So let's add this. Now let's move that exception logic, that is the log error function logic, to the exception project. So I'm going to cut from here and let me go to the exception project here. Now because this logic is related to logging the exception in the file, so let's give a name to this saying file exception. Right. Now we have used stream writer over here, so we need to ensure that we import the system.io namespace. So that error has gone off. Now we also have some error here. That's just because, you know, that this exception is a reserved namespace and our project is also named by exception. So let's say this as exception. How do I say it? Exception namespace. So that. And let me just rename everyone to exception namespace. Now I can use your exception. Right. So what we have done is basically we have created a simple file exception. So we have moved the logic from the business object into this file exception class. Now what we can do is, let's just compile this project. We are going to get some couple of errors here. So the first error is that currently in the business object there is no log error exception, the log error function. So let me just go and remove this. Let me again just build this. Right, there is no log error function, right? Right. Now, what we can do is, we can reference this exception project into our business object. So, let me add a reference to the exception project, class project. Press OK. Right, so you can see that the exception project is now added to the business object. Now what we can do is, we can go ahead and use our exception namespace, And wherever we want to log the errors, what we can do is we can create the object of the exception class, the file exception class. So I can just say file exception, obj is equal to new file exception, and I can just say obj dot, I think we have made the function as private, so let's make it public. So obj dot log error ex. Probably what I can do is I can make this as a class level variable so that I don't need to instantiate this again and again. So let me just make a control X over here and let me paste it over here. Make it private so that it's not accessible outside the customer class. Now wherever I want to log the errors, I can just say obj.logError.ex. And let's build this. Right. So what have we achieved? What we have done is basically we have moved the exception logic now into a different project altogether. Now let's say if I want to add, let's say, event viewer, you know, error handling routine. So what I can do is I can just take this control C, control V, and I can say event viewer exception, and I can write my logic for adding errors into event viewers. Now we have solved the problem partially, you know, but not fully, because if you remember, right, our main goal was whenever we add a new class here, we don't want to make any kind of changes in the customer object or in the middle tier. But now when I add a new class like event viewer exception, I have to go and create a reference of the event viewer exception over here. So that goes nowhere. So in other words, if I add a new class here, I have to go and create an object over here. So again, I have to go and change in the middle tier or in my business object. If you watch closely the customer class, the change in customer class is happening. Why? Because you know, you are directly referencing the class names here. So you can see that basically because you are referencing the file exception, then tomorrow when you add a new class over there, for example, the event viewer exception, you have to again refer the same, you know, in the customer class. So if somehow we can get rid of this direct names of the classes here, we are in a better position. In other words, we need to refer an interface. So we have to somehow get rid of this exception class, which is the exception project, which is nothing but this project. So in other words, we have to get rid of this reference is what is happening in the BO, and the business object and the middle tier will actually refer this exception class via an interface. So if we can replace this concrete classes by some generic interfaces, you know, that would solve a problem. So let's first go ahead and add a simple interface. So let me go and add a new project. And let me add an interface called as iExceptions. So let's go ahead and create a simple interface here, iEx. And let's create a simple function here called as logErrorExceptions. And now let's reference this interface in our exception class and implement this interface in all our classes, you know, all our exception classes. So let me go ahead and reference this interface in my exception project here, and let me import this iExceptions, and let me implement iEx in all of my exception classes. Now in our business object, that is in our middle tier, we'll remove this concrete class reference and we'll add a reference to iExceptions. Now what we'll do is we will only have a reference to iExceptions. Now you can see that because we are only referencing to iEx, that is the interface name. So we'll only have reference to our iEx interface, which is been implemented by all of our exception classes. Right. Now, this IEX interface is a generic interface. So tomorrow, if you add any kind of new classes over here, you don't need to worry anything about it in your customer class. So in other words, any kind of new changes or any kind of new class you add into your exception namespace, you know, you don't need to change in your customer class. Now the next question would be that this is an interface. So how do we create the object of the interface? Now in order to create the object, right, we will use a factory pattern. We'll use a factory class. So let's go ahead and create a new project here called as factory. Now what this factory class will do is, this factory class will reference both the exception class as well as the interface. So he will refer both the interface as well as the concrete exception classes. And in this factory class, let's say we give some nice name to this CLS factory. We have, let's also import the namespaces and also our concrete namespaces. Now, this factory class will return back, you know, the objects, the strong type objects. So for example, we can create a simple exception function here, which will actually accept integer values, and we'll say that if I is equal to 0, then return back new CLS new file exception, else return back new event viewer exception. Right. Now the factory class takes all the trouble of creating the objects, but he always returns back a very generic interface. Now in our business object, in our middle tier, you know, we will use the factory here to create the exception objects. So in other words, this business object will now refer the factory class to punch out objects. So let me go and refer the factory class here using factory, and I can see here now is equal to CLS factory. I think it's public. Okay, let me make this a static so that it's much more readable. Right. So now I can say, okay, if I give 0, it will give a file exception. If I give 1, it will give an event viewer exception. Now tomorrow, if I add, let's say, some more new classes, right, I need to just go and add over here and go and add the exception class into the exception project. I don't need to make any kind of change into my customer class here. So if I want to create the file exception, I'll just pass 0 here. And this value, right, 0, 1, 2, 3, you can always fetch from your web config file. So must be in your web config file, you can make a entry like this saying exception key or something. And then you can read those values over here, right? So in other words, probably I can do something like this configuration. System.configuration. So must be I can just say something configuration.app settings of the exception key. Exception key. Because this is an integer value, I need to just convert this to an int. Now, so let me build this project first. Now, let's say that if you want to add a new exception, you will change only in two places. One is the exception project itself. So the change number one, you'll go and add a new class here saying, let's say, email exception. We'll implement the interface. We'll write a logic. So you'll write a logic here. Logic to send an email, right? And then you will go and return. So you'll go to your factory class and you will say, if somebody passes me, factory class here, factory class. So I'll say, okay, else if I is equal to 1, event viewer, and anything other than 0 and 1, I will return a new email exception. So you have now changed only in two places. One is the factory class and the other one is in your concrete class. Now in a web config file, you can easily go and say that, okay, please go and use the email exception. You don't have to do anything other than this. So if you rebuild this project and if you run this, so that's my project running. So because, you know, currently there is an exception, I have not created any database, so that's why this data access layer logic is actually failing over here. I have not debugged through that. So what it has done is it has actually gone and invoked the exception class. And you can see that because we have provided the value as 2 here, right, it is now going and using the email exception. So in other words, what we did, let's look into our solution explorer. Initially, we had a 3-tier architecture. We had the business object, we had the UI, and we had the data access layer. But then, you know, the problem was that the logging, the error logging utility, or the error logging logic, I will say, was in the business object. So we created a different project altogether called as exception project. But again, there was a problem. This exception project was directly referenced in the business object. So what we did, we provided an interface in between I exceptions. Again, we had problem. How do we create an object of the interface? So for that, we use the factory class. So in other words, we started with the problem of, you know, the SRP violation, that is single responsibility violation, where the customer class was doing a lot of work. And then by using factory patterns and interfaces, we came out with a complete solution where now, you know, the exception logic is completely decoupled into a different project altogether, and the customer project is completely into a different project altogether. Now, the customer project has only one reason to change, or the customer class has only one reason to change, when there is a change in the customer code property or the first name property or the last name property. While the exception logging utility has only one logic to change, you know, when you add a new exception logic. So in this way, by using SRP principle or by following SRP principle, we have completely decoupled both of these classes. Now when you change logic in one project or in one class, it doesn't affect the other class. Thank you very much.